सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां रामो राजमणिः सदा विजयते रामं रमेशं भजे रामेणाभिहता निशाचरचमो रामाय तस्मै नमः रामान्नास्ति परायणं परतरं रामस्य दासोऽस्म्यहं रामे चित्तलयः सदा भवतु मे भो राम मामुद्धर समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं मंगलमूरति मारुतनंदन सकल अमंगलमूलनिकंदन पवनतनय संतनहितकारी हृदय विराजत अवध बिहारी माता गुरु गणपति शारद शिवा समेत शुक नारद चरण कमल बंदौ सब काहू देहु राम पद प्रेम निभाहु जय 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 हनुमान गोसाई कृपा करो गुरुदेव की नाई बंदौ राम लखन बैदेही यह तुलसी के परम स्नेही यह तुलसी के परम स्नेही बाल समय रवि भक्ष लियो तब तीनहु लोक भयो अंधियारो ताही सो त्रास भयो जग को यह संकट काहु सो जात न तारो देवन आनी करी बिनती तब छांडी दियो रवि कष्ट निवारो को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो बाली की त्रास कपि सब से गिरी जात महाप्रभु पंथ निहारो चौकी महामुनि साप दियो तब चाहिय कौन बिचार बिचारो कैद्विज रूप लिवाय महाप्रभु सो तुम दास के शोक निवारो को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो अंगद के संग लेन गए सिय खोज कपीस यह बन उचारो जीवत न बची हो हम सो जु बिना सुधी लाय इहा पगुधारो एरिथ के तट सिंधु सब तब लाय सिया सुधी प्राण उबारो को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो रावण त्रास दई सिय को सब राक्षसी शोक ही शोक निवारो ताहि समय हनुमान महाप्रभु जाय महारजनी चर मारो चाहत सिय अशोक सो आगि सुदय प्रभु मुद्रिका शोक निवारो को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो बान लग्यो उर लक्ष्मण के तब प्राणत जयसुत रावण मारो ले गृह वैद्य सुषेण समेत तब गिरि द्रोण सुबीर उपारो आनी सजीवन हाथ दई तब लक्ष्मण के तुम प्राण उबारो। को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो। रावण युद्ध अजान कियो तब नाग की फांस सब सिर डारो। श्री रघुनाथ समेत सब दल मोह भयो यह संकट भारो। आनी खगेश तब हनुमान जु बंधन काटी सुत्रास निवारो। को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो। बंधु समेत जब अही रावण लय रघुनाथ पताल सिधारो। देवी ही पूजी भली विधि सो बलि देव सब मिली मंत्र बिचारो। जाय सहाय भयो तब ही अही रावण सैन्य समेत संहारो। को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो। काज किए बड़ देवन के तुम वीर महाप्रभु देखी बिचारो। कौन सो संकट मोर गरीब सो जो तुम सो नहीं जात है तारो। बेगी हरो हनुमान महाप्रभु जो कुछ संकट होय हमारो। को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो। को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो। लाल देह लाली लसे अरुधरी लाल लंगूर। वज्र देह दानव दलन जय 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 कपि सूर। सियावर रामचंद्र की जय। पवन सुत हनुमान की जय। उमापति महादेव की जय। बोलो भाई सब संतन की जय। श्री सद्गुरुनाथ महाराज की जय। हरिओम। So over the last few classes in Sankat Mochan, we have been seeing how Hanumanji helped a lot of devotees to come out of their Sankat. Devotion to Hanumanji gives a sadhaka an inexplicable strength to face Sankat, challenges, where to the outside world it might appear, oh, this sadhaka is going through so many difficulties, so many challenges. But if you ask that sadhaka, he will say, I'm okay. That is the kavacha, or as though, you know, an inner strength, a protection. Kavacha means a protection, which is gained by this sadhaka through devotion to Bhagavan. Hanumanji in our text, Sankat Mochan. And the last line keeps coming in every verse, which is, Ko nahi janat hai jagame kapi sankata mochana namatiharo. Who doesn't know, Hanumanji, your strength, which is able to take away the challenges in my life by giving me strength to go through those challenges. Now somebody comes and says to Hanumanji, Hanumanji, do you only take away problems of few people? Or are you partial? You know, like you said, you take away problems, you are Sankat Mochan. But whose Sankat do you take away? Is it only few people that you come and help? Or is it everyone? So Bhagwan says in Bhagavad Gita, Samoham Sarva Bhuteshu Name Dveshosti Napriyaha Ye Bhajanti Tu Mam Bhaktya Maite Teshu Chapyaham. What Bhagavan says there is, Samoham Sarva Bhuteshu means I am same in everyone. And there is nobody who is dear to me or somebody whom I hate. Name dveshosti, nobody I hate in particular, nor is someone very dear to me. But, you know, he always adds that condition. Tu means but. Those who worship me and offer all their actions unto me, or those who recognize my presence in their life, they become mine and I become theirs. Meaning they will derive an inner strength through which they can come out of sankata. Few examples that are always given in Vedanta or in our parampara are that of a fire. Is that of a fire? You know, when there is a huge fire and there is somebody who is shivering out of cold, fire says, I am equal to everyone. There is nobody whom I want to give more warmth, nor somebody whom I want to keep away from. But if this person is sitting far away and just, you know, trying to blame that fire, saying that it's partial, those who are sitting, you know, close by it is giving warmth, and those who are sitting far off it is not giving them warmth. So that person, we will say, why are you saying that? Just go close to it and you will bask in its warmth. Same way with sunlight also. Sunlight is not partial. It will just shine all over. But wherever the reflection medium is clean, there the brilliance of that sunshine is found. In the same way, Bhagwan's grace, you call, or Bhagwan's willingness to bring devotees out of sankat is same for everyone. He says, I'm waiting for you right here. Come, just approach me. Now you will find that all these devotees whom we saw, right, in the previous four verses and also the fifth one, there was some quality about them because of which they were helped by Hanumanji to come out of sankat. What were those qualities? We will just try to just glance upon them. Okay, we won't go too much into detail. First sankat we saw was of devatas. So devatas went to Hanumanji while he was trying to devour the sun. And with that action of theirs, Hanumanji has to release the sun and everything was back to normal. Devatas represent Dainya Bhava. Dainya Bhava means becoming small in front of Bhagwan. And this is something Bhagwan loves. I had heard something from our one Swamiji who was, you know, very renowned Mahatma. He said, whenever we build huge Gopuram, right, whenever you go to our ancient Indian temples, you will see so huge structures built there. And this Mahatma said that the purpose of building these huge structures is just to remind us that Bhagwan is that big and I am so small in front of Bhagwan. Means requesting his help to lead us in our life. That is Dainya Bhava. So that's why Hanumanji said, Devana Ani Kari Binati. You know, they went and humbly prayed to Hanumanji. Next sankat we had seen was of Sugriva. Sugriva symbolizes Dasa Bhava. Means one who is ready to surrender to Bhagwan. And when Hanumanji introduces Sugriva to Bhagwan Ramchandraji, Sugriva says, Bhagwan, I am yours now. I am your Dasa. You tell me what I should do. Means he trusted Hanumanji and readily became Dasa of Bhagwan. So that is Dasa Bhava. To such a Dasa, Goswamiji said, Kedvija Rupa Livaya Mahaprabhu Sotuma Dasa Ke Soka Nivaro. So when we have Dasa Bhava in our life, Bhagwan's grace comes, help comes. Next sankat we saw in the third verse was the monkeys who are waiting on that shore of the ocean. Monkeys symbolize sadhaka bhava. Means we also, in our lives, and we saw in that verse, right, that monkeys, that ocean represented deha abhimana, trying to overcome body identification. So we also as sadhakas try so many sadhanas. You know, we try japa, we try meditation, we try bhajan, so many other things we try. We do shravanam also. When we do all those sadhanas, there is sincerity on the path of sadhaka. And when this sincerity is coupled with seeking grace of Bhagwan, there the sadhaka is brought out of that challenge. Sankat means deha abhimana we can cross over when we have the sincere sadhaka bhava along with seeking Bhagwan's grace. Heri thake tata sindhu sabe taba laya siya sudhi prana ubaro. Means these monkeys who were struggling so much there, everybody was sincerely trying. You know, they were trying to estimate their strength, trying to help each other out, but yet they were unable to. So that is where Hanumanji came and helped them out. Then we saw Sankat of Sitaji, who was sitting in Ashok Vatika, lamenting over her decisions, lamenting over, you know, things that have happened in her life. But we saw one thing in Sitaji there, that she would constantly keep her mind in Bhagavan. Her eyes were on her feet and Nama Smarana, name of Bhagavan, was always on her lips. So that was Bhakti Bhava. Means her desire or intense longing for Bhagwan was such that Hanumanji said, now I have to help her out, bring her out of her sorrow. Chahata siya asoka su agisu de prabhu mudrika soka nivaro. So Hanumanji drops that mudrika and helps her gain that inner strength by which she is brought out of sorrow. Last one we saw was Lakshmanji, who was hurt by Meghanada. Lakshmanji symbolizes Seva Bhava. Means 14 years, Lakshmanji served Ramchandraji without looking anywhere else. There is a Marathi Aarti, or an Aarti which is sung in Marathi. One line comes there, which I very much love. You know, it says, Lakshmana Sevakari Ramachandrachi, Chauda Varshe Ahara Nidra Nahi Tayasi. Means if anybody has to serve or learn how to serve, we should learn from Lakshmanji. When he was with Bhagwan Ramchandraji, Ahara Nidra, food and sleep, was nothing that came to his mind. Means this is just to show his single-pointed devotion to Bhagwan Rama while serving. So when a sadhaka has such seva bhava, Hanumanji says, Ani sajivana hatha diye taba lachimana ketuma prana ubaro. Means Hanumanji brings him out of sankat when he has to go through it. So these are just ways of dwelling on different aspects of Ramayana. It's so deep that more we dwell on it, more we benefit in our own sadhana, in our own opening of knots of the heart. You know, Hrudaya Granthi, main Hrudaya Granthi is broken by Jnanam, right? But these are like other knots which are there, which get broken when we realize that these are the aspects I need to cultivate in myself so that I can benefit from this knowledge, live my life discovering my true potential. Okay, then we saw Lakshmanji's story. We were on verse number 5, where we saw that in this war between army of Bhagwan Ramchandra ji and Ravana's army. Various warriors are getting defeated now. And Meghnad says, I am going to jump into the war. And Ravana is very happy. Lakshman ji comes. He says, he takes Bhagwan's permission and he comes there to fight. And Meghnad sends one Shakti, Veera Ghatini Shakti, by which Lakshman ji as though becomes unconscious. Nobody was able to lift Lakshman ji, but Hanuman ji casually lifts him and comes to the camp. And there they realize they have to bring Sushena Vaidya from Ravana's camp. So Hanuman ji goes to Ravana's camp, brings doctor along with the dispensary. Okay, just in case if we lose something behind, why simply go back? So he brings both of them and places there. And now Hanumanji is told that he has to get Sanjeevani herb from the Himalayas. So Hanumanji is ready to go. You know, he just jumps and goes. But on the way, he meets one Rakshasa by the name Kalanemi. And this Rakshasa was sent by Ravana to just make sure that Hanumanji's progress is slowed down. Because the condition was, before the next day, he has to bring back the mountain. And then we saw Hanumanji recognizes that he is a Rakshasa and then gives him or releases him from his body. Kalanemi Rakshasa. And that line which Kalanemi had said to Ravana is really beautiful. He's giving advice to Ravana and he says, Neela Kanjatanu Sundara Syama Hrudaya Rakhu Lochanabhirama. Means in your heart, meditate on form of Bhagwan Rama. Lochanabhirama means always be craving to see that form of Bhagwan. Leave aside all these things that you are trying to do. So to such a bhakta, Hanumanji gave him what he wanted. So now Hanumanji comes to that mountain where he was supposed to come and take that mountain. Actually, he was not planning to take mountain first. He had come to take that herb, but he couldn't recognize which is that thing because he wasn't a doctor. So he thought instead of going there and realizing that it's the wrong herb and then coming back, we don't have that much time. So he lifted the entire mountain and started his journey back. Now what happens on the way back is he flies over Ayodhya. And while he is flying over Ayodhya, Bharatji sees him. Now Bharatji doesn't know Hanumanji. And this was late in the night. Now one thing to note here is, late in the night, Bharatji is sitting outside looking up in the sky. Means Bharatji did not stay in the palace. When he came back from the forest, Bharatji went to a village called Nandigrama. And it is said he lived there like a rishi. He used to run the kingdom, but he lived an ascetic life just like Bhagwan Ramchandra ji would live in the forest. So Bharatji sees somebody going up with a mountain. So he says he did not recognize and he wanted to know what is this, because he is a king. He should know if somebody is, you know, flying above his kingdom. He shoots a pointless arrow. These pointless arrows are wonderful in Ramayana. Again and again they come. Not to kill him, but just to check who he is. And just as Bharatji shoots that arrow, Hanumanji starts coming down, 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 as though he is falling unconscious. And he is son of Vayudevata. So Vayudevata realizes that this mountain cannot afford to fall on Ayodhya. So Vayudevata holds that mountain and only Hanumanji falls on the ground. And you know, we realize here, why are so many obstacles coming up in Hanumanji's path? First it was Kalanemi. Now his journey is slowed down by Bharatji's arrow. lot of commentators, they point out here that before going, before Hanumanji was ready to go to Sanjeevani, to get Sanjeevani, Hanumanji did praise of his own strength. It is said, Chala Prabhanjana Suta Balabhashi. Means these are reminders as though that if we ignore Rama Pratapa, Bhagwan's Pratapa, and have some kind of pride in our own strength, that is where we meet with different obstacles. So Bharatji realizes that this Hanumanji is Bhagwan Ramchandraji's Duta. Because he says Rama Rama. You know, Hanumanji has always Rama Rama at his, in his mouth. So Bharatji feels very sad. You know, he says, what have I done now? And he tries to revive Hanumanji. And he realizes he's unable to bring Hanumanji back to life. You know, he's just too tired and he has fallen down unconscious. Bharatji says a very nice thing. He says, if my devotion to Bhagwan Rama is without any deceit, if my thought, words, and actions are all in line with my devotion to Bhagwan, O Lord, may Hanumanji, may his strain, may his tiredness go away, may he come back to senses. This is called Nishkapata Prema. Means love for Bhagwan which doesn't have any other adulteration as though in it. Now he, just as he says that, Bhagwan's grace works and Hanumanji comes back to senses. Bharatji is so happy, at least Hanumanji is, has been revived now. So he embraces Hanumanji and says that I feel so sorry that one is I couldn't help Bhagwan Ramchandraji in his work. And now I have put an additional obstacle. I know that we are losing time. You have to reach there before morning. And this medicine also, you know, is time sensitive. That's why he's even more worried, Bharatji. So Bharatji says, Hanumanji, I will do one thing. Along with your mountain, you sit on my arrow. And I will send you straight to Bhagwan Rama. You don't have to worry about your flight anymore. You just sit along with this mountain. I will take care of the rest. Now Hanumanji feels me and the mountain together on that arrow. How is that arrow going to bear that weight? Suni kapi mana upaja abhimana. Again, he is reminded of his own strength. He says, I am so powerful. Why do I need to sit on that arrow? But suddenly, he realizes that this entire thing is to teach me something. Rama prabhava bichari bahori, bandi charana kaha kapikara jori. He realizes that I should not doubt Bhagwan's pratapa. Bharatji is promising this not on his own strength, on the strength that he is devotee of Bhagwan Rama, and that strength will help him go across. So that is his realization, you call, you know, one moment of spark where he thinks and realizes that real strength has to be invoked from Bhagawan. And then we have to do what we are doing. So he tells Bharatji, Bharatji, I have got your message now. I myself will become that arrow and now finish the task. You know, this arrow is something very interesting. Arrow doesn't have its own purpose. Its purpose is, what is the purpose of its master? Okay. Wherever the master wants the arrow to go, there this arrow will go. But while this arrow is going, the master is unseen. Okay. once it has been released, what is seen is only the arrow. So the lesson here is to realize that the strength of this arrow doesn't belong to the arrow. It belongs to the master who has wielded the bow and who has left this arrow. And its purpose also is that of the master. So with that in mind, Hanumanji goes further on his journey, remembering the devotion Bharatji had, remembering the kind of surrender Bharatji had towards Ramchandraji, just deriving joy out of that remembrance. Now when Hanumanji reaches their camp, on the way, before Hanumanji has reached, Bhagwan Ramchandraji shows his love that he had for Lakshmanji. Sometimes some expressions of love are unsaid. They get expressed in certain unique situations. And this love with Bhagwan is sometimes such that a devotee wonders, you know, I love Bhagwan. How does Bhagwan love me? In what way does he love me? So here is an description, you call, or a kind of portrayal of Bhagwan's love for his devotee. Bhagwan goes to the extent of saying, Lakshmanji, if I had known that you would be hurt in this war, I would have not hesitated to go back on my father's words. Dashrath Maharaj, when he told that you should go to the forest, if I had known this, I would have not even come to this forest. He says, how will I go back and respond to the citizens of Ayodhya who are so much eagerly waiting for all of us to come back if something has to happen to you? How will I face Sumitraji, who sent you thinking that I will give you all joy, all happiness, and I will give you protection? How will I respond to her? So saying this, Bhagwan Ramchandraji is just lamenting in the love for Lakshmanji. And you know, suddenly everybody feels a little dejected. Where is this, you know, going towards? When they see the leader, you know, getting so emotional. At that moment, Hanumanji arrives with his Sanjeevani. So suddenly the whole atmosphere which was there changes and everybody is now revived. Everybody is happy, saying that Lakshmanji is now saved and our war against Ravana will continue with even more strength. And as Hanumanji arrives there, Bhagwan Ramchandraji takes him in his embrace. And then he says, how can I repay back what you have done to you, what you have done to me? So, and Bhagwan's love for Hanumanji was so intense that, you know, he just took him in his embrace, and with that they were just in each other's company. And of course, Lakshmanji was revived, and later on, the story moves forward. But most importantly also, Hanumanji returns back Sushena Vaidya along with his clinic and dispensary. And, you know, he's put back to where he was. Something to reflect here. Who is Meghanada? Meghanad's another name I had mentioned was Indrajit. Indrajit means one who has won over Indra. So he had done this battle once and he had won over Indra. And he is son of Ravana. Ravana represents moha, you know, delusion. And Indrajit, who is his son, represents kama, you know, desires which are there. And the sankat, in this particular verse is lack of dispassion sometimes when this arrows of desires hit us. Veera Ghatini, that was the name of that astra, right? Veera means that which takes away strength. So when this arrow of desire strikes, it takes away the strength of the sadhaka. And this we can see even in our day-to-day life, that it makes us unconscious. Unconscious means asleep to our goal. Either it is any worldly goal that we have, and also the spiritual goal which you say, which is knowledge of the truth. So these arrows of desire hit and make a sadhaka unconscious. So that is why it is said, keeping senses under control, so that these arrows don't hit as badly as they would. Sometimes, you know, we don't like this word control. We say, you know, why unnecessarily bring in this topic? But let us think about it. Potential of anything can be harnessed only when it is controlled. Right? Potential of anything can be harnessed only when it is controlled. We see like a huge river flowing. But if we have to harness the potential of that, we have to build a dam, right? Control the flow of water and then harness its potential. Whether you see a beautiful car, you know, which has a lot of features, great speed, everything is great, except it doesn't have brake. Okay, all the features are not going to be very helpful. Control, right? That is the most important part when we want to use something to its best, fullest potential. So even when it comes to ourselves, right? When it comes to mind, our rishis understood this very thoroughly. They said, if we have to discover our potential, first thing is we should control dissipation of energy. So that is where they introduced this concept of dhamma. Dhamma means controlling the senses back and allowing the mind to go, allowing the senses to go where the intellect wants them to go, not wherever they want to go. And we see that whenever mind is distracted, right, because of senses going wild, our performance is not to the fullest. Whether you see a sport where some sportsmen are not allowed to play some games because they were indulgent the previous day, they might be physically fit, but mentally they are not prepared to play a particular game. So it is said we should save ourselves from this arrow, you know, Veera Ghatini Shakti. And what is the best way to save ourselves? It is said, do satsang. Bhagwan Shankaracharya ji told this to us in Bhajagovindam. He said, satsangatve nissangatvam. Means dispassion you call, or ability to see things clearly will come through satsang. Means we should try to soak ourselves, soak our intellect in the thoughts of Gita, in the thoughts of Ramayana, and allow them to interfere in our life. Because these thoughts, when they start interfering, right, doesn't matter whether it is only during the satsang, it will gradually start happening outside satsang also. Whenever we are doing certain work, whenever we are about to take some decision, there these thoughts will come and guide us. Okay, so that is our way of saving from this Veera Ghatini Shakti, which will take away our, you know, discrimination. And person who is not too much attached, right? One who has dispassion. That person will always be fearless. I remember one top executive from railways in India, a man of noble character who has served the railways for so many years. Once, for some reason, there was some failure in one of the railway projects. And generally, when such a failure happens, everybody is ready to point fingers at each other, saying that, you know, this person is responsible. And the fingers always go to the topmost person. And he is, you know, pressurized to resign or step down. And this person's character was so strong, even before anybody could say anything, he declared saying, I take the full responsibility of what has happened, of this failure, and I myself step down. And everybody was surprised, you know, such a decision coming from such a top executive. People, why to get that post? Whereas he is trying to say that I'm ready to step down because of taking responsibility. People had to come together. The government had to come together and say, please don't step down now because we understand such things happen and we need you to stay there. The point here is, when we have right attitude, right dispassion towards things, we become fearless. That post did not, because of, you know, detachment towards that post, you call, or right attitude towards that position, he was able to take the right decision, detach himself and see that situation. So that is this power of having right thinking, you know, dispassion towards things. And the best help that we can get in this entire journey is that of Hanumanji. Because Hanumanji symbolizes Brahmacharya, you know, one who has mastered senses, one who is ready to, or one who has gained victory over these situations. And his help, when we seek, we can come out of situations like these. Last thing to note here is that Sanjeevani herb, which was there, right? Goswamiji himself says later that this Sanjeevani herb represents devotion. You know, bhakti is that herb which will bring dispassion alive. Okay, so when that herb is brought and given to Lakshmanji, that dispassion, you know, Lakshmanji, which is there in him, which had as though become unconscious, that comes back to life. So that is something to dwell upon, that what is this herb which I have to bring in my life so that this dispassion becomes more alive, more vibrant, and more powerful to face any obstacles. So with that, we will move on to the next verse, which is also another scenario now. It is same word seen only, which is going to a little later portion.
रावण युद्ध अजान कियो तब नाग की फास सब सिर डारो श्री रघुनाथ समेत सब दल मोह भयो यह संकट भारो आनि खगेश तब हनुमान जु बंधन काटी सुत्रास निवारो को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो को नहीं जानत है जग में कपि संकट मोचन नाम तिहारो.
Now, as Meghnad was fighting and he gets defeated by Lakshmanji after Lakshmanji is brought back to senses, Ravana starts fighting the war. And Ravana was also a powerful warrior and he knew a lot of Maya
know, he knew not of Maya tactics while fighting the war. And it is said, Ravana Juddha Ajana Kiyotaba Naga Ki Phasa Sabai Siro Daro. Ravana releases an astra which is called Nagapasha. Means it does not kill that person. It just goes, that snake goes and ties that person up. Okay, this is Nagapasha. That is a new astra that Ravana had. And everybody is tied. Bhagwan Ramchandra Ji. Shri Raghunatha Sameta Sabedala Moha Bhayo Yaha Sankata Bharo. And they don't know what to do because they don't see anybody here who is able to move because everyone is tied with this Nagapasha. Hanumanji was the only one who was not tied. Who did not get tied by this. And at the right time, Narad Muni comes there and says to Hanumanji that go and bring Garuda now. You know, Garuda is Vahana, vehicle of Bhagwan Vishnu. And Garuda's enemy is snakes. So he says it will work out perfectly. You go and bring Garuda to handle this situation. So Hanumanji quickly goes and brings Garuda, who sees everybody tied, but he is able to release everyone from that Nagapasha very easily because he is a very powerful, you know, bird, Garudji. And then the war resumes. You know, everybody is freed and everybody is able to come back and fight. So this was that Sankat where Hanumanji helped Ramchandraji and the entire army come out from this Nagapasha. Now, little bit we'll dwell on what is this Nagapasha, the symbolism behind this. And you know, again and again, we should offer our gratitude to Pooja Swami Swarupanandji, who has brought out all this symbolism behind all these verses. You know, only with Swamiji's commentary, only with Swamiji's guidance to look at this topic, we are able to understand the subtleties of what these situations mean to us. Snake here represents samshaya, self-doubt. Self-doubt about anything. Whenever we start doing something new, whenever we take up a big project, we take up a bigger goal in life, there is a doubt, you know, whether I'll be able to accomplish it or not. That is this Nagapasha. Means it does not do anything. All it does is makes us not act. That is how Nagapasha is, you know. It will just make you stay there. It won't kill that person. But he is not able to take the next step to move forward on his journey. That is this role of Nagapasha. And what does Hanumanji do? He brings Garudji. And Garuda is symbolic of Shastra and Guru. It is said, Sama Veda has come from the flapping of the wings of Garuda Bhagavan. Means when that knowledge comes, when that right attitude comes in our life, we are freed from that Nagapasha. Now you can take it in both goals, okay? Whenever we have goals in our own life, right? Whether it's a project you call or some new task that we are approaching. This vision of Bhagavad Gita, vision of believing in our own potential, vision of believing in totality and seeking help from Bhagwan, that itself will help us come out of samshaya, doubt. But also when we look at it from standpoint of a sadhaka, right? When the sadhaka, his first doubt is whether I'll get realization in this birth or not. Whether I have the qualifications necessary to walk on this path. Oh, it seems so difficult, so much of, you know, terminology, so much of things, so much of, you know, expectations from Vedanta you call or scriptures, how am I going to walk this path? Doubt, samshaya. All of that is cut asunder when a teacher comes in our life and shastras come in our life. This we have seen in many places that Vedanta says it doesn't matter where you are right now. All that is needed is our willingness to walk this path. He says, sadhaka makes one step. Bhagwan says, I will help you now. Okay. In either goals, even in the world, any of the goals that we have, Bhagwan says, find that thing that you want to gain. Think only of that thing what you want to gain and seek my help to gain that thing. And then you see how you can get it. When it comes to spirituality, there also Bhagwan says, spirituality means adhyatmik goal, moksha purushartha. There also Bhagwan says, don't worry about qualifications too much. Means don't get disappointed because of qualifications. Make sincere effort. Drop this doubt that, you know, whether moksha will happen in this life or anything. Start walking sincerely. So that is when Hanumanji brings Garuda Bhagwan and removes Sankata, which the sadhaka is facing. And Swamiji mentions, Swarupananji, a beautiful point here, which he says Gurudev used to mention. So it is, you know, coming from parampara. That one thing about Garuda is that he can fly high, but at the same time, see any small little thing even crawling down on the earth. Means he is having that higher vision, but he is able to come down and fix any small things which are there. And Swamiji says, for a sadhaka, what this means is that either whenever we have clarity about a bigger picture of life, we should also be able to come and detect any small negativities which are there in our life. Only with that, we have this ability to scale up and scale down also. Means flying high, knowing what is this bigger picture of Vedanta and having a clear vision. But in case if we find anything which is to be fixed, being able to come down and fix that thing. So this is something which we see from Garuda Bhagwan. So we are at the sixth verse now. We will pause here and continue with the last two verses and do the Purnahuti in the next class. And also, I will be taking few questions which Jignesh Bhai will be announcing right now. So please stay back. And there are some few other announcements. We will chant Purnamada and then have the announcements. Om. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.